Now James Robertson welcomes in the new year with an affirming ghostly tale, written especially for BBC Radio Scotland listeners. The Mannie.
Dinna be feared, she told herself. He canna help being what he is. Look at him. See, she looked at him, and he looked back out a grey, searching in, as if he was wanting to tell her something. He was old, with siller bristles on his chafts and thin patches of white hair on his head, like dun on a brown speckled egg. He had on old grey working clothes, but nae bits, just grey socks on his feet. He'll have taken them off at the back door, she thought, out of habit. The kindness in his face minded her of her feyther. But this wasn't her feyther, he was lang dead. This was a Mannie she'd never seen afore, stonin' in the kitchen, as if it was his ain. The next second he was awa'. This shocked Elspeth mair than him hain been there in the first place. She went to the back door just to check, but of course there were nae bits there, and when she come back it was as if she'd no seen the Mannie either. But she had. She wondered what it was he'd been wanting to tell her. The ghaist hadna flegged her muckle, but the farmer's wife chapping at the windy made her loup. Oh, aye, she kent yon Mannie was a ghaist. The way he stood, no speaking, and no solid but transparent, like gauze, like the difference between a richt plump o' rain and a licht smear. If she'd raxed out to touch him, there'd have been naething there, she kent it without trying. See, she hadna tried. I brocht ye some eggs, Agnes Fraser said, bringing into the kitchen and putting the box on the table. Fresh laid the day. Are ye settling in fine? Aye, thanks, Elspeth said. It's a braw wee cottage. Weel, we spent a bit on it, Agnes said. She had a harsh, rockle way of speaking that wasn't unfriendly, but Elspeth didn't think she'd thole any nonsense about ghosts. Just as she wouldn't understand about her painting and the soothing effect it had on her. How she could lose herself for hours, working through the upstairs windy, watching the hills and the fields and the woods and the farmhouses, just painting, painting, trying to catch, no the details, but the colours, the shadows of the clouds and the eye-changing licht. Shade and licht, that was what she was after. And she scanned the land and the sky till she couldn't see a tree or a house or a clood. She just saw shade and licht. And that was what she painted. Och aye, it's cosy enough, this place, Agnes said. Now, dinna you be blate about asking for onything. If something's no richt, just let us ken. That's awfu kind, Elspeth said, but I'm fine, really. Will you let me pay you for the eggs? Agnes snorted, I will not. Well, do you hae time for a cup of tea? I'll no say no, said Agnes. In the late afternoon, when Elspeth came back down to the kitchen to make herself mair tea, there was the Mannie again. He was sitting in the same chair that Agnes had sat in. Elspeth said, "Weel, Mannie, you seem richt at hame here. Would you like a cup of tea?" Daft, but what else was she to say to him? She biled the kettle and made a pot and poured out the twa mugs, and he never moved, just kept watching her. She kent he wasna going to tell her how he took his tea, so he got it black with nae sugar, the way her feyther had ta'en it. She pushed the mug over to him, no that she thought he would touch it. "You dinna bother me," she telt him. "I'm fey, ye ken. Have I been fey? Real folk bother me mair than the likes o' you." And she was on the pint of saying something about when she was merit, what it had been like before she walked out, no kenning what mood her man was going to be in, his drinking, her fear, the scunner and shame of it. She was about to speak about all that, but she stopped herself. Yon was all byway. She didn't want to bring it into the cottage. "What is it you want to tell me?" she said. "Did you bide here, Yince? Does it fash ye, me being here?" He looked at her with a kind of yearning. she felt the need to step out by into the sunshine for a minute. Over the field she saw the farmer and his tractor, Agnes's man, back and fore, with a long plume of gulls out to hint him, rising and falling like papers blown in the wind. When she came back in, the Mannie wasn't there. She lifted his mug, full as it was, to scale it in the sink, and it was cold. No, just cold. It was freezing. She put her finger in it, and it was icy. "Och, you poor thing," she said. But she didn't really ken what she meant by it. "So what's she like, her new tenant?" Bob Fraser asked, putting the last of the plates into the dishwasher while Agnes was getting the table adicht. "Oh, she's nice enough," she said. "She's quiet-like. There's something about her. What is it she does again?" "She's a teacher. Oh, and an artist. She says she could paint the view frae the bedroom window forever." "No bad if you hae the time, eh?" Bob said. "What do you mean, there's something about her?" "I'm no just sure," Agnes said. "She's run away frae a man, I doot. But there's something mair. A secret. As long as she pays the rent and doesn't put paint in the carpet, she can hae all the secrets she likes," Bob said. There was just a week left before the schools went back, and Elspeth didn't want to lose any time. After her breakfast of boiled eggs and toast, she never stopped all day. It seemed to her that she was teetering on the edge of something. The sky turned grey, blue, blay, black. The tractor cut across her view. Sheep and kye grazed the green parks. She couldn't work fast enough to capture it all. By the time she was done, you would hardly ken tractor or beasts had ever been in the painting. They were mere traces of themselves, the faintest echoes on the canvas. And if what she'd painted was a landscape, it wasn't real. It was mere like a place that dreams might venture into, a floating, eerie space. She aye had the window open at night. The moon kicked in at her through the clouds. There were lichts in the faraway houses, and syne they went out, and it was just her and the moon. She fell into a deep sleep, but as the dawn was rising, she woke to a creak on the stair. She sat up. The door swung open, even though there was nae breeze. "Is that you?" she cried, but nobody came in. She got out of her bed, lifting the poker that she'd brought up frae the sitting room. She went to the door. Nathan. She went to the other room. The greyness crept in at the window and touched the canvases set against the opposite wall. They seemed to be alive in the shilpit licht, like strange, unkent creatures. Back in her bed, she cooted down like a bairn. The uncanniness of the paintings didn't make her feared. It calmed her that they were there, alive or dead. Something had happened, but she didn't ken what. She felt a new assurance that nae harm would come to her in this place. She never saw the Mannie again, no in the cottage. She looked for him, but that was nae use. If you looked for ghosts, they never showed themselves. But on the first morning of the new school term, as she was loading her car, she suddenly got a gliss going at the road end. He was looking out over the fields. But when she shut the boot, it was as if he heard it, for he turned to the sound, and it seemed to her that his horn went up in a kind of greeting. She raised her horn back, and he flickered and faded away. Maybe it wasn't a greeting, she thought, as she slowed the car at the spot where it'd been. Maybe it was a farewell. "I've seen you richt, lass, and knew I'm on my way." Just for a second, a knot was in her thrapple. Syne she pulled out onto the main road and drove aft to teach the bairns how to paint.